I'd like to welcome and thank Sherry McConnell for coming. Sherry's going to be sharing more history about the Redbud Quilt Guild. Mm-hmm. There's quite a fun information there for us all to hear. But in the meantime, I think we should all know just how talented this lady is. She has been a 30-year member of the Quilt Guild here in Anderson. She also right now is president of the Evening Star Quilt Guild. She just finished her term as vice president of the board of directors of the Quilters Guild Hall of Fame.
Quilters Hall of Fame, yes.
And that's in Marion. She also was head of the exhibits for the Marie Webster House in Marion, mm-hmm. which is the home of the Quilters Hall of Fame. Mm-hmm. It's a very historic building and place to visit. Sherry designs, teaches, lectures, and is a freelance pattern tester and sample maker for several different fabric companies in this area and around the United States. Mm-hmm. She is multi-talented, obviously, and credits her passion for quilting and the art of it to her mother, mm-hmm. her grandmother, and her great aunt. Sherry and her husband, Tom, own a business here in Anderson called Pieces. Mm-hmm. Welcome, Sherry.
Thank you so much, Jean, for having me today.
I know you've worked this into your busy schedule because you're going to Indianapolis to the Historical Museum this afternoon.
Yes, I'm going to the Indiana State Museum. They're showing an 1876 leaf and acorn quilt, and I've been invited to see that quilt.
You're very lucky, and I hope you'll take pictures.
Oh, I will, if I'm permitted, I certainly will.
We'll be anxious to hear about that one. You heard before we got started, some people ask, is the Redbud Quilt Guild a guild, a league, a club? Could you explain the difference to us a little bit about what that is?
The Redbud Quilt Guild is exactly that, a guild. Early in its history, they determined that the name would be a guild. And a guild is an organization of craftsmen. That makes it different from a club. A club is more social. You'll come together for civic activities, community service activities, to enjoy each other's company. But with a guild, the craftsmen come together. You don't have to be proficient in the craft. You just have to have a desire to learn and to broaden what you do and to become more educated mm-hmm. and to make a difference in your community. Because most guilds do have community service activities, and we're no exception. We have those through the years. but it is a collection of artisans and craftsmen. And for us, it's specific to needlework and the quilting arts.
Okay. Would you tell me a little bit more about some of the activities? You mentioned that there are lots of activities that you do.
There are lots of activities.
And the goals?
The goal of the guild, and we actually have an object statement that describes that we're here to teach and to learn at the mm-hmm. same time, mm-hmm. because how can you teach and not learn yourself, mm-hmm. and to promote the art of quilting to anyone who is willing to come and be a part of our group. Or it's interesting because as a guild, you have opportunities to do other things. For us, through the years, there have been many opportunities because we're over 30 years old now. Mm-hmm. And actually, we're 35 years old, I guess.
How did it get started?
It got started with an organizational meeting that was held in May of 1980. They put a call out in the newspaper. We actually have the newspaper clippings because we have a historian that keeps track of all of these things. They met at the Redbud Room at the library. Okay. 44 attended the first organizational meeting. And from that, they divided into two groups. One group was called the Day Stitchers because they could meet in the daytime. The other group was called the Night Stitchers because they could meet at night. And that was mostly women who worked and maybe babysat their grandchildren during the day. Excuse me. And the night group continued for 3 years mm-hmm. and then disbanded because the president didn't want to be president anymore and no one else wanted to step up. So
then that happened.
It does happen. We currently have an evening guild that we're in our ninth year, and that's somewhat of a success story because, again, we're dealing with women who work, young mothers. We have mm-hmm. young mothers. The youngest member in the evening group is 13. The oldest member is 102.
That's nice that you have young people.
It is. Ruby Webb is our oldest member.
And how old is Ruby?
102. She just turned 102.
Oh, my goodness.
She missed last month's meeting because she was touring the Scandinavian islands. So
at 102.
At 102, she couldn't come.
Good for Ruby.
But from that first effort in the Quilt Guild, it has been continuous. A lot of the people who were in the original sign-in sheets, and we have those original sign-in sheets, are still members. I came in 1985.
I was just going to ask you if you were at the original...
No. My mother and I quilted together, and we didn't see a need for an outside guild at that time, although it was interesting, because she and I had taken a class at the Anderson Area Vocational School, and it was a two-semester class taught by the curator of social history of the Indiana State Museum, Kathleen McClary, and you paid $10 a semester and you got a diploma at the end of it.
How exciting.
And from that group in that class, some of those became charter members of the Quilt Guild, which was interesting, I thought.
Yeah.
So then the day group continued and the night group continued for those 3 years, and then the day group just went on and on and on. They've done many things over the years. The most prolific amount of work has been done for Pregnancy Crisis Center, Valor Quilts. Which,
so when you're saying the most things that you do, it's around making quilts for...
Yes, those particular community service projects. They used to be held once a year. Now it's an ongoing kind of thing you can always make, and there's always someone to take them
up. Mm-hmm.
But there's other organizations that we support. We supported Dove Harbor by cash donations for a little while.
Rather than quilts.
Mm-hmm. We did the Pregnancy Crisis Center for quite some time. We provided quilts for Beauty from Ashes in Alexandria. They do walker bags and all sorts of things you can make, tissue box covers for the nursing homes. Mm-hmm. 1 year we did 35 quilts for the Christian Center. And that was a very, very fun project to do.
Do you ever get to see people receive these quilts that you're
sometimes
taking for charity?
Sometimes.
That must be rewarding.
It is rewarding. More often, the director comes to the meeting and they're presented with the quilts. Mm-hmm. There's a group in Florida that actually has a blessing on their quilts, and it's a whole meeting, and then the organizations that are chosen come, and they're honored, and the quilts are dispersed. The Pendleton Quilt Guild provides over 100 quilts a year for Riley Hospital. So different guilds do different things, and you can change those through the years, which we have. Valor quilts weren't necessary at the beginning of our Quilt Guild life, but they became necessary with all the war. And so that was a huge project that we were involved in. And the nice thing about it is you don't have to do it if you'd rather not. Mm-hmm. You can participate or not participate. The opportunity is there. Mm-hmm. But we do have members who are very dedicated to what they do, which is great. Mm-hmm. One really fun project that not only our guild, but the Muncie Quilt Guild and the Pendleton Quilt Guild got involved in, we actually did handmade clothing and quilts for Sandy Allen, the world's tallest woman.
Oh, my goodness.
I was involved in helping do a vest for her. And then
that is very interesting.
It was very fun. Then we got to go to the a reception in Indianapolis, and we met her, and all these things were presented to her.
Did she know you were doing it?
Yes.
So has she sent measurements for
all
Yes.
of you? Yes. She had
goodness.
Sent measurements, and then she was a skilled artisan on her own, and she was provided with sewing machines and knitting machines so she could make her own things.
Oh, my. Are there pictures of that?
Oh, yes. Yes.
Those would be
Absolutely.
Fascinating.
Yes.
And I'm not sure. Is she still with us?
I don't believe so.
I'm not sure. That.
No, I don't think she is.
Has quilting always been real popular, or has there been an ebb and flow in it? Or
definitely an ebb and flow. In the early days during the Depression, quilt making was a utility thing. But also during the Depression is when you had your World's Fair quilts. And you have books and articles that are written about these. They're highly sought after. We had an exhibit at the library for the Quilters Hall of Fame a few years ago. And Mary Kay Waldvogel actually owns some of those quilts, and they were on display. And these were made by women. They thought they might have a few hundred entries, and they had thousands. And there was a prize. I mean, cash was very important at that time. Mm-hmm. So their best quilts came into play for those particular types of contests. Mm-hmm. Then it's sort of with the onset of World War II, the onset of women going into the workforce, and the ability to buy what you needed. You no longer had to make everything. Then quilting sort of took a back seat, although in the rural areas and in different areas, quilting was still very strong. Mm-hmm. And the quilt groups were meeting. A lot of this happened in home extension. Out west, we hear of quilt groups that met during the Depression. We had a lot of designers coming forward at that time. And we had a lot of Kits, Hirshners, and Lee Wards. And
oh my, that's a familiar name.
Yes, and actually there were two or three kit companies in Indianapolis. And we still do research and we find those kits from time to time. So all of that was very prevalent at that time. The huge resurgence came with the bicentennial of the country.
And okay, I was going to ask when that started.
Yes, yes. And then the first quilt show in a museum in New York City. With the resurgence of that and the popularity of that, and suddenly quilting wasn't just for the beds, quilting was for the walls. Then everyone got back into making things and wanting to create their own piece of art for their home. They wanted to cover their families. And so the quilt guilds began to come about.
Back at the bicentennial. And it was New York that did it?
New York had one of the first major quilt shows that was held in a museum. And it was very popular and something that hadn't been done, and it just brought the whole thing. Suddenly the artists were on board, designers were on board, fabric companies got into the swing of it. From there, quilt shops opened. We have quilt shops in Indianapolis that have been going strong for nearly 40 years.
Oh, no.
Original owners have these shops. It's just amazing to me. Now, for our quilt guild, during that time, we were growing. We'd be high in number for a while, and then it would ebb off, and we'd have a lower number. But the teaching never stopped for the Redbud Quilt Guild. Every year, the programs were designed so that there was education, there was opportunities to learn, workshops, trips, any new article or new tool that was out there. See, I started quilting before the rotary cutter.
Oh my.
So when they introduced the rotary cutter at the Quilt Guild, naturally we all had to have one.
For our viewers, a rotary cutter looks like a pizza cutter.
It does look like
pizza cutter, and it's essentially a razor blade.
Absolutely.
Very sharp.
Very sharp.
You learn to keep your fingers tucked tightly when you're using your rotary.
Yes.
I'm sorry. Go ahead.
No, absolutely. That's exactly what it is. But it made it possible for us to do so many more things. Mm-hmm. Well, now the guild has the opportunity to learn the strip piecing methods, and then came Mary Ellen Hopkins, and her book was It's Okay to Sit on My Quilt, and you did classes with her, and a lot of the guild members went down and took classes at Quilts Plus in Nora, which is still there, but you were sworn to secrecy because the methods were secret, and if you took the classes,
you had to take the classes to learn the secret, and then
you couldn't share. Although finally they let us, and we went crazy. The guild went crazy.
What finally triggered allowing you to share rather than keeping it a secret? That'd be
public
pressure
to make these methods available, and the fact that it was just like wildfire, and she couldn't be everywhere.
To keep it from happening.
And she couldn't be everywhere to teach. So she began to train people, and they came back, and then they could teach, and then we could go out and teach our guild.
So the whole process, the wall just came down.
Exactly right. Exactly right.
So that's fascinating.
That's where we began working that. Then there were other opportunities. We've always had speakers in.
From all over?
From all over the place, yes. So it's a constant... It's constantly an educational format.
Mm-hmm.
Now,
and that's one of the goals.
That's one of the goals, one of our directives. Mm-hmm. And we call it the object of the Redbud Quilt Guild. It's in our bylaws.
For education and teaching and always learning more.
And sharing. Mm-hmm. Yes, absolutely. Okay. Absolutely.
Okay. That's obvious. I know the other thing that I find interesting is the difference in fabrics as the years have gone by. I was looking at pictures of the Guild in years gone by versus now, and what struck me were fabrics.
Mm-hmm.
Can you share a little bit about that, since you work to design fabric? And
I do work with quite a lot of different fabrics. In those days, we had a very limited accessibility to good fabrics, what we would consider good fabrics.
Mm-hmm.
The weave was not as dense as it is now. The feeling wasn't the same. We had come from feed sacks and other dense fabrics of the early days, and now we were going into the 70s fabrics, which were softer, more loosely woven, and less money.
Mm-hmm.
We still had the money issues. We were still experiencing layoffs and tight budgets, and so quilting wasn't a necessity when it resurged. It was an option.
Mm-hmm.
It was something everyone wanted to do. So there had to be fabric out there that could be afforded by the everyday housewife and everyday quilter. Because now we were making pieces and we were making clothes and we were doing all the things we wanted to do, but it had to be affordable. Because in most cases, still in the 70s, most women were at home.
Mm-hmm.
So
You're right.
Most women were at home. So you had this little budget that you had to work with. But you could say to your husband, I can make this. And he would be glad. And then you could save money and buy fabric and create a stash, which was wonderful.
Mm-hmm.
But fabric now, the design of fabric, we had a period that was mostly calicos, multicolored prints, more a country look more than anything. Now anything goes. Fabrics feel like silk. We work with silks in fabric. We now can create our own fabric. There's a company called Spoonflower. I can go to my computer, I can design what I want on my fabric, and then I can send it to Spoonflower, and they print it, and I get the fabric back.
Wow. How long does it take?
I'm not sure. It depends on what their timeline is. Mm-hmm. It doesn't take very long. One company I work for now, we work with what we call CAD fabric. The fabric is designed through a CAD program, and I work with computer-generated fabric. If I need a quarter of a yard, I call and go, look, I don't have enough to do this sample. I need a quarter of a yard. They push a button, print the fabric. I have it the next day.
That's amazing.
You can't do much with it because it's not heat set. It's not a final fabric, so you can't let it get wet or it disappears. But it is a way to get samples done at a less price.
Oh, okay.
But then the main fabric that you buy comes from those CAD projects. So fabric now is just wonderful. The hand, the feel of a fabric is important to us. How many times do we go into the quilt shop or the fabric store and we just run our hands along and we feel
the
fabric?
All the time.
And you're like, oh, yeah. Oh, no.
And also, I think for people that are just hearing about quilting for the first time, everybody's famous for a stash.
Yes.
It's hard not to go in a quilt shop and come out with some more for your stash.
Mm-hmm.
The other thing that I find really interesting, I was working on a quilt that my mother had started and was taken by friends to a shop that, as soon as they saw it, they took me to a section that was reproduction.
Absolutely, absolutely.
Do you do any of that?
We do. I work with a number of reproduction fabrics. And I work with the actual fabrics through my work with the Quilters Hall of Fame.
Mm-hmm.
We have the actual fabrics up there. The rule is that if a person owns a 2x2 inch square of an original historic fabric, they can create a fabric from that.
2x2?
2x2. As long as you own a piece of it,
you can create.
So you'll walk into the quilt shop and you'll see the reproduction sections. And there might be, you might go to one artist such as Jo Morton, and you look at her fabrics, but then you walk over here to Karen Witt and you think, but that looks almost like it. And it is similar because those fabrics were so prevalent at that time. But yes, a lot of the fabric is reproduced now. There's a company in, I believe it's Pennsylvania, if they're still in business, they actually recreated the block prints. And the way you know a block print fabric is that they actually carved the design on a block, and then they put it on the fabric and they'd hit it with a mallet and it would jump, so you have a little shadow. And that's how you know it's an original block print. And they are recreating those block prints.
My goodness.
But the reproduction, they go into the 40s. The mid-1800s is a very popular time for picking up reproduction fabric. It has such a beautiful color mm-hmm. to it. And the blues and the reds were so rich.
Oh, yes. Some of the
and the creams
come out from museums.
Absolutely.
They speak of the deep reds and the blues. Those two colors are always seem to be mentioned more
absolutely.
Than any other.
Absolutely.
Or if you see one on the Antique Roadshow.
It's always a red or blue quilt
that
has those shadings
about.
In it. Mm-hmm. But every quilt shop will have, they'll have a section of reproduction. They'll have a section of modern. They'll have mm-hmm. a section of novelty fabrics. They'll have mm-hmm. a section of basics. In today's world, you can find almost anything you want. Mm-hmm. Quilt shops do specialize. Mm-hmm. And that's what's exciting about a guild. A guild is made up of so many different voices.
Absolutely.
A show and tell, you might have 20 people, and it's 20 different voices of fabric, 20 different genres of fabric.
And show and tell, again for the viewers,
show and tell
is, I'll let you tell them what is show and tell.
Show and tell is the part of the guild that everyone loves the most, mm-hmm. and it's when you bring your work that you've either completed, in progress, or you need some help with, mm-hmm. you stand up in front of the guild and you present your work. Mm-hmm. Now, it's funny, when I first joined the guild, I was so naive. When I first joined the guild, I thought that was required. I thought I had to have a show and tell every month. It kept us busy and it kept you focused mm-hmm. and it was fun. So I had a little something.
Every month.
Every month, because I thought you were supposed to.
So you got a lot made.
I got a lot made, I did. But now show and tell, it can be anything. It can mm-hmm. be, if you're working on a community service project, we show those. Mm-hmm. Anything quilting or needle art related mm-hmm. comes up in show and tell. In our evening group, show and tell is so huge that we no longer have a business meeting. We put it in the newsletter. We might have 24 to 28 people each month showing show and tells. And of course, there's a story with it. You have to tell the story. And sometimes they're sad stories. Sometimes they're happy stories. Sometimes they're funny stories.
Yeah, but hearing the story behind quilts is fascinating.
Absolutely.
And I know you've brought some samples today for us I want you to be able to share a little bit in terms of their stories mm-hmm. and what they're about.
The quilt here behind me is called Stars Across America. The quilt features thimbleberries fabric, which is a very unusual coloration for thimbleberries. It was very popular when it came into the shop. It sold out in about an hour and a half, it felt like. But each star represents a woman of strength in our United States history. We have Eleanor Roosevelt. We have Marie Webster. There's other, Harriet Tubman is in here. All the different stars reflected someone. This particular quilt was taught as a year-long class at a local quilt shop. When they were done, they had this complete quilt. The pattern itself was designed by Eleanor Burns of Quilt in a Day, which some of you will recognize that. And it continues to be one of her most popular books, popular patterns, and it is always a popular class. The quilt next to this one is called Heartstrings. The fabric was designed by Terry Dakenkalb. She designs fabric for Red Rooster Fabrics, and Terry actually lives in Noblesville. I was hired as a sample maker and an editor for her books, and she asked me to make this piece, and this features all of her fabric. And it was quilted by Deb Geyer of Anderson, who is also executive director of the Marie Webster House and Quilters Hall of Fame. I particularly love this piece, all the different fabrics, all what we call fussy cuts, which means you center the design and you incorporate it into your quilt. But what I love are the different sayings. Terry's famous for her sayings. I made this quilt for her. It hung at a wholesale trade show. And then she gifted the quilt back to me. So it's one of my very favorites. And the backing is lovely. So this is a very beautiful quilt, very warm quilt. Comes in more of the muted colors that we think in terms of. One of the very special things that a quilt guild does is if if you've come to the end of your time as president, and in Redbud you serve a year and then you have the option to serve another year. At the end of the second year, they present you with a gift. This particular quilt was given to me at the end of my second term as president. I was president for 2 years, and then a few years later, I was president for 2 years again. Peggy Sanguinetti and Brenda Wilson, and I believe Candy Lawler, pieced this, chose the fabrics, and then they had all the guild members sign. The signatures are very special to me. These are women who have taught me, who I've been with for a lot of these, for the 30 years I've been in the Quilt Guild. And when I read those names, it brings back memories of trips, shopping trips, workshops, wonderful events. But a guild is more than that. When you look at these, for me, I came into the guild after my mother died. And I had a two-month-old. My youngest girl, I have four daughters. My youngest girl was just 2 months old when I came into the guild. And these women became my daughter's grandmothers, and they became my sisters and my mothers. Mm-hmm. And they formed who I am today. They're dearer to me than anything I can even tell you. So when I look at these signatures, it brings back the times when my girls and I were involved in something and they came to see us. Mm-hmm. They care about each other. Husbands become friends. Mm-hmm. It's a lifelong gift. Being a part of a quilt guild is just a lifelong gift, and it makes a difference in your life. So those signatures are very, very special to me, and this was a very special gift.
Well, Sherry, I want to thank you for coming today and sharing your wealth of information. I know there's much more that we weren't able to hear because of time constraints. I hope the audience has gained from it, and I'm sure they have. I look forward to the next shows. We're going to be having more quilt shows, Redbud quilt shows here on Channel 18 about more quilts and stories behind quilts. We have another one planned on color concept that's amazing to hear about. And also, we're going to be having some teaching done, showing you how to make a quilt and get started in that direction. So thank you for watching, and we thank you again, and we look forward to the next one.
Thank you very much.